All right, so we're going to wrap up today by introducing some basic x86 instructions and their opcodes. Obviously, there are way more instructions than what we'll cover today, but this is enough to get us started, and then we'll spend the next week or two learning more instructions and how to combine them in more complicated ways. So probably the most basic instruction is the move instruction. This handles data movement, as you might imagine, and it copies the data from the first operand to the second operand. So for instance, move $1, comma, percent RAX means move the immediate value 1 into register RAX. So this essentially sets RAX to 1. There are arithmetic instructions. So for now, we'll work with add, sub, and IMUL. Notice that it's IMUL, not just MUL. So there's addition, subtraction, and multiplication. The way this works is that it's going to perform the operation with the two operands, and it's going to store the result in the second operand. So that second operand needs to be a register or memory operand. So for instance, add RCX RAX will add the value of RCX to the value of RAX. And I just noticed this should be the percent operator right here. Note that we're not using a division operation right now. There is a division operation in x86-64, but it's more complicated to use. And so we're just going to ignore that for now. There are also bitwise operations that work similarly to the arithmetic operations. So there's AND, OR, and XOR. Again, it's going to perform the operation and save the result in the second operand. All right, so we're also going to introduce some very basic control flow and decision structures here. So control flow in assembly is somewhat complicated, but we'll learn a very simplified form today, and then we'll expand on that in a later day. So the basic idea is that normally you always execute instructions in sequence. So once you finish executing one instruction, you go to the next one, and then the next one, and the next one. So that's that fetch, decode, execute cycle that we were talking about. But it is possible to change the flow of execution and to execute a different instruction rather than the one that's immediately following the instruction that you're currently executing. And that's what's called a control flow change. And so in order to effect a control flow change, we need a way to change the program counter. Because you can't set the instruction pointer directly in x86-64, we have to do this with jump instructions. So the way this works is that you mark a location that you might want to jump to using a label. A label consists of some sort of name followed by the colon symbol. And then you can jump to that label using the JMP instruction. So for instance, jump foo will jump to a label foo, and the labels need to be unique. This is what's called an unconditional jump. This is not quite as useful as a conditional jump, so a jump that only happens if a particular condition is satisfied. So here is sort of a very basic introduction to how this works. There are a lot more details that we'll cover about this later on. But conditionals are actually implemented using two instructions in x86-64. So you'll run a comparison instruction, or CMP, followed immediately by a conditional jump instruction. So for now, we're going to focus on just JE and JNE. So again, the CMP instruction compares two operand values, and then you need to follow that CMP instruction directly with either a JE or a JNE instruction. These will jump to a label if the preceding comparison was equal or not equal, depending on whether you use JE or JNE. So for instance, if we said compare RAX to 0 followed by JE foo, this will jump to foo if RAX was 0. If we had say JNE foo, it will jump to foo if the value of RAX was not 0. So jump equal, jump not equal. And again, there's a lot, this gets a lot more complicated, but this is sufficient for now. So it's worth pausing here and making sure that you're tracking with all of this. So here is some assembly code. So you should pause the video and see if you can determine what the value of RAX will be after all of these instructions execute. Or maybe they don't all execute. So that's part of the question. Okay, so the first instruction is a move instruction, and it essentially sets RCX to 5. So it moves or copies 5, the immediate value 5, into RCX. The next instruction ANDs, so this is a bitwise AND, of the immediate value 0 with RAX. And you may be a little worried at this point, well, I don't know the previous value of RAX. How do I know what the result of this instruction is? But if you think back to when we studied the bitwise operations for integers, we know that one of the properties of the AND operation is that anything ANDed with 0 is always going to be 0. So in fact, it doesn't matter what the value of RAX was before this instruction. This is just going to set RAX to 0. And again, this shows you where there are kind of multiple ways of doing things. So we could have done move 0 RAX, but we could also do AND 0 RAX. Turns out there's actually another way of doing this. And so I will give you the hint that it involves the XOR instruction and see if you can figure it out based on that. In any case, so we've set RCX to 5, RAX to 0, then we compare 0 and RCX, and we do a jump if they are equal. So the question is RCX equal to 0? And it is not currently equal to 0, it's going to be 5 because it was set to 5 up here. So this jump will not happen. We will go ahead and execute this next instruction, which adds RCX to RAX. So that adds 5 to 0 and stores the result in RAX. So RAX is now going to be 5. And then we just keep executing, which means we get to this label. Labels don't have any effect, so we just keep going. And then we get to this subtract instruction. So this subtracts 1 from RAX. Since RAX was 5 after this add, the final value of RAX is going to be 4. Okay, so at this point, it's going to be useful to be able to handwrite and test x86-64 assembly. And so this is sort of a minimal template that I know works on Stu. So you can copy this into a file on Stu, save it as a .s file, and then you can compile it with GCC as usual, except that you don't need to use the C flag. And then you can run the program, and the final value of RAX is going to be the return value of the program, which in Bash you can examine using the echo $?? Command. Although at this point, it's probably going to be more useful to step through the program with a debugger to see how the machine is changing state as your program is running. And so I recommend running it in GDB, and here are some commands that are going to be useful as you're debugging machine code instructions instead of C code. So for instance, we no longer have any C code to list, so we may want to be able to look at the disassembly. So disassemble, or just DISAS, is going to print the disassembly. Now we don't have statements, so we can't go to next statement. So we need to go to the next instruction, which is the NI command. There's also step instruction, SI. We can print the value of registers. Note here that this actually is the $ RAX. GDB is a little confusing in this respect, in that it requires you to use a $ for the register names instead of the percent sign. Or if you just want to look at all the registers, you can use info register. So I encourage you to play around with this. Again, one of the things that I hope that you get out of this course is just the willingness and the ability to experiment with things. And if you have a question, try it out and see what happens.